Good morning. Happy New Year. Feliz Año Nuevo. Ah, look at that. Great. Hey, in case you don't know me, my name is Tony Campos. I am the pastor of a church that started here in 2005. And it's now the first German church of Sacramento. We have services in German and Dutch. Yeah, you know that we're, I'm the pastor of Casa de Luz, a mostly Latino, Hispanic church. Not everything is in Spanish, but we've been there for a number of years. And our church sends greetings. They're very happy when they heard that I was going to be here, and also happy that you delivered them from me for one Sunday. You know, they were so happy that, oh, he's going to be there. That's good. But, you know, great things are happening at Casa de Luz, and everybody was excited that I was going to share with you some of the things that are happening in our church, and I will do that later. But you know, just know that we love you guys and we miss you. And Casa de Luz is growing and maturing, and God is doing great thing among us. So we're happy for that. And just if you know a little bit about me, in July of 1998, boy, that's a long time, 1998. My wife and I were just fresh out of Bible college. We signed up a open letter to be missionaries to whatever the church wanted to send us. And that was kind of naive, I know, but we were like, yes, we want to do this. So we said, whatever you want to send us, we'll go. So the church, our church at that time sent us to a little country named Belize. And it's in the Yucatan Peninsula in Central America. And we were happy to go there. And in July of 1998, my wife and I and our daughter April, who was 3 years old at that time, left. We went there. I was excited. You know, I was anticipating what God was going to do. I was a little bit nervous, but for the most part, I was like just expectant and excited and happy for what was going to happen. But my perspective began to change rather quickly as we flew over Belize, the city of Belize. I saw a small patch of houses in the middle of this dense vegetation and trees. And, you know, on one side, you have the beautiful Caribbean Sea, vast and enormous. And on the other side, we had the Macal and Belize River, just humongous rivers like I've never seen in my life. And then I began to think, what did I get myself into? You know, we arrived in the country, we landed, and we walked through immigration. We encountered people that were different from me, and they spoke a different language that we barely understood, almost nothing. We managed to go through immigration, and you know, we found ourselves in the lobby of the very tiny airport. We had an address, so we gave it to a taxi driver, and he took us to where we were going, you know, driving on the side of the road by the river. You know, all I could see was green and some monkeys and the river. And I was like, I'm really now starting to freak out. And not because I haven't seen monkeys in all of my life. I've seen monkeys and rivers too. But I just realized that I'm in a different country, with a different culture, people that are so different from me. A language that I don't understand, let alone speak, and everything is different. So I'm not thinking what's going to happen. You know, it's a tiny country. We lived in the years before that. We lived in Mexico City, that at one time was 21 million people in the city, and we're moving into Belize that is 250,000 people in the whole country. And so I'm thinking, what is going to happen now? There is some apprehension. There is some anxiety. The common things that happen to you when you enter a new season in your life. And we've all been there, right? We all, in some way or another, have experienced something new in our lives, some new season, some new beginning. Maybe last year or right now you're starting a new relationship, or maybe you just got married, or you had your first kid or your first grandkid, like in my case. Yes, I do have a granddaughter. She's somewhere around there. And I know what you're thinking. He's so young and so handsome and so hot. How could that Latino sexy man have a granddaughter? Yes, I do have one granddaughter. You know, maybe last year you started your own business, or you got a new job, or you started college, and there's this new season in life. You know, maybe today you decided to come to church for the first time and check it out because you've never been to church, but you figure, it's the first day of the year, I'm going to go to church to see what happens. And you're thinking, if these people are for reals, if they're not hypocrites like you see in the media, if this God is real, if this God is safe, you're thinking it could be a new season for me. I don't know if I want that. I don't know if I want to change the life that I have at this moment for the life that, you know, these people seem to have. Even more, maybe it is possible that some of you went through some hard times in your life last year. Maybe some of you suffered the loss of a dear family member, or maybe somebody went through a divorce or a family split or something, and you're looking to the next year, this year coming, you're thinking, how is that going to be? How is that going to work? The future just got a little darker. And you know, in every season, in every new beginning, even every new year, bring its own challenges and worries. It creates some anxiety, and we start to wonder, how is this going to play out? How is that going to be? You know, as a country, we're entering into a different new season in our world. You know, things are changing right before our eyes, and we might not know what is going to happen tomorrow. How is it going to be? And in this new year, the first day of the year, it's sort of like a new beginning too. Because every year you make, you know, your resolutions and you set your goals and you say the things that you want to accomplish. But this morning, I want to invite you to something a little different. And you probably hear this because if you've been to church before, you usually hear from pastors that God is doing a new thing. Have you heard that? Yeah, God is doing a new thing. We love that. Pastors and churches, we love to say that. God is doing a new thing, but we don't know what's the new thing. We never know. We never find out. And I always think about this because if it's a new thing and it is from God, then it should be obvious, right? Well, let me share with you what I think is the new thing that God is doing, because this new thing is very important for us. Let me clear out, you know, right away that this new thing I'm talking about is a new way of life. It's a new way of life to which God himself is inviting you into. And the passage I'm sharing with you this morning will help us gladly discover, that even in the midst of our challenges and uncertainty, we can prosper in this new life that God is inviting us to, in this new beginning that God is inviting us to. Because this new thing that we always talk about in church, this new thing is a new life. And this new life has a new way, sort of like a new beginning that God is inviting you into. So if you have your Bibles, please go to Philippians chapter 3. We're going to start in verses 3 and going to work our way down to the 12. Well, let's start in 4. Paul is speaking to the church, to the Philippians, and he's talking about, you know, righteousness in God, and about, you know, his kind of like his former life. And in verse 4, he says, "Though I have myself have reasons for such confidence, if someone else thinks they have reasons to put confidence in the flesh, I have more." If someone else thinks that they have reasons to put confidence in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised on the eighth day of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews, in regards of the law, a Pharisee. As for zeal, persecuting the church. As for righteousness based on the law, blameless. So this is Paul talking about his life that he had at one moment. You know, I was with a friend the other day. We were in a car together, and as we drove by a very large church building, and my friend is not a believer, so he made a comment about the church building and how beautiful it is, and you know, some of the good things about the church, and I took the opportunity because you know, if you are a believer and you have a friend that is an unbeliever, you're always looking for the opportunity to share the gospel, and if you don't, you feel guilty about it, right? It's like, gosh, I should have done this. You know, the guy who does my hair, I could do that every time. Anyway, so I'm driving with my friend, and as he mentioned that, I took the opportunity to share my testimony with him and to tell him how God has changed my life. I told him a little bit about my upbringing as a teenager, the kind of trouble I got myself into, and how there was no future for me and no hope until God rescued me, and how God changed my life. And so at one point, I asked him, would you like, you know, God, for God to change your life? I was expecting that he would say, yes, I do want God to change my life. He kind of looked at me in a funny way and say, why would I want that? He said, I have a pretty good life. I have a good job. I have a good family. I don't do a lot of bad things. I go to church sometimes. And he said, why would God want to change that? Because I like the life that I have today. And I tried to explain to him that he was evaluating his life only in terms of the things that he has, his accomplishment, but he wouldn't understand. And I get it, because a lot of people, in fact, a lot of Christians are like that too. They claim that their lives are good because they're evaluating their lives based on the things that they have today. You might be thinking right now, even yourself, that there's nothing wrong with your life, that you're a good person, you have a good family, a great job, I believe in God, I go to church. And all those things are good things. They're good things. But remember, sometimes good is the enemy of best. Sometimes good is the enemy of best. So Paul begins by saying that if anybody has anything to boast, any accomplishments, any good things in his life, he says, look, if you think that you've got it together, I have more. And then he begins to list the things that are important for the culture in which he lives. First of all, he says he's a Hebrew of Hebrews. He said he was circumcised on the eighth day, which means his parents were good Jewish parents. They followed the law of Moses. They took him to whatever, you know, the temple or somewhere else to be circumcised. They were good Jewish parents. So from the very beginning, he's saying, you know, I grew up in a good Jewish family. My parents were good people. I was circumcised on the eighth day. He said, I am from the people of Israel. And you know this because you've probably been in church for a long time to know that the people of Israel is God's chosen people. It's the people of the promise. They are the descendants of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob. So what he's saying here is like, look, I am no second generation. I am not a Greek Jew. I'm not, you know, my parents, both of them are, they have heritage and they are part of the people of Israel. I am a child of the promise. I'm part of the special people of God. He also says, I am of the tribe of Benjamin. And when he says that, it's very interesting what he says, because Benjamin was the son of Rachel. And if you know anything about the story, you know that when Jacob wanted to marry Rachel, he wasn't given her. He was given the older sister. So what Paul is saying, look, I'm not the son of the other one. I'm the son of the one my father loved. My father worked for this woman, and when he couldn't have her, he was given the other one. But I am the son of Rachel. So I'm a Hebrew of Hebrews. I have good stuff in me. Not only that, but if you remember something interesting about the tribe of Benjamin, when there was a little crisis during David's kingdom and they wanted to overthrow him, the tribes of Israel, they left them. They betrayed him and left. And they said, Israel, to your house. And they left. There was one tribe who remained with King David. You know who was that? Exactly. It was Benjamin. So he's saying, look, I'm a Hebrew of Hebrews. I'm not a betrayer. I'm no second generation. I am pure breed. My parents were Jews. I got everything. Not only that, he says, I'm also a Pharisee. From a very religious, very passionate, very concerned with always doing the right thing. In fact, he says, by the standards of the law, the teachings of the rabbis, not necessarily the fulfillment of the law, but the way in which the rabbis interpreted the law by those standards. He says, if you point at me and try to judge me, you cannot, because I am blameless. Those are pretty heavy words. And he's saying is, you could go check with the rabbis and you could ask them and they will tell you, Paul, he's the man. He is blameless. He cannot be judged according to our teachings. So Paul is up here when it comes to the values of his culture. He's a good, religious, patriotic, educated, impeccable man. He's got a good life. He's got a good life. And it got me thinking that we live in a culture that encourages confidence in the flesh. Just like he was talking about, you know, that his own culture, that they looked at the accomplishments of one person to judge them. Here today in our culture, we realize that the world in which we live today encourages confidence in the flesh. The money we save for retirement, the house we are able to buy, the car we're able to drive, the education we get, the church we attend, the people we hang out with. And look, these things are not bad, except when it is the only life that you want to live. These things are good, except when these things become the only life that you have. Because when you settle for these things, you are settling for something much less valuable than that, than what God has for you. I tell this to our church most times, almost every Sunday. I tell our church, because it's made up mostly of Hispanics. And I usually tell our church, look, you left your country. You left your family behind. You probably came into this country illegally. You broke the law in order to be here. And there is only one reason for you to be here, and that is because you believe you will have a better life in the United States. Translation there, you'll have more money. Right? Well, some people come for other reasons, but for the most part, most people come in search of a better life. I'm not saying it's bad, I'm just saying that's a reality. And then I tell our church, look, you came because of the American dream. But in the process, God gave you his dream. But there is always going to be a competition between the dream that you came to pursue and the dream that God has for you. But this is not a thing just for Hispanics. We look at our own lives today, we look at the culture in general, and we realize that there is always a competing value in our lives. There's always going to be a challenger for the life that God has to offer us. But this new way of life that I'm talking to you about goes beyond religious affiliation. It goes beyond patriotism. It goes beyond education, political views, or anything else that this world finds important. Because this new thing of God is a new life. And this new life has a new way, sort of like a new beginning for us. You read the next verses with me in verse 7, because Paul just described the good life that he had, the good credentials, the good moral standards that he had. And then if you move on a little bit down to verse 7, you'll find this. It says, but whatever were gains to me. Please read this carefully, because I know this passage is very familiar to a lot of you. And when something is very familiar, it loses its meaning. It loses its grip on us. But read this carefully. It says, whatever were gains to me. Whatever the things that I mentioned before, my credentials, my heritage, my political views, my status, my education, whatever was gain for me, I now consider loss for the sake of Christ. What is more, I consider everything a loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. Very heavy words. You know, before you let go of the old way of life, you need to realize how good the new life is. I have a garage in my house. Most of you have a garage in your home. That room is for you to drive your car in. Don't do what I do. I store stuff in it. I have, you know, I clean it now and then, but it's always full of stuff. And the reason why is because sometimes people offer me things and it's like, hey, Tony, do you want this chair? Sure. And my wife's like, why did you take the chair? I don't know. They gave it to me. Like, we don't need it. Well, somebody might need it. Let's just put it in the garage. So for about a year, I've been telling my wife that I want to get a rowing machine. It's a device. It's a machine that you sit on it and you pretend you're rowing. You know, it's for exercise. If you want to look this good, you need to exercise. Did I just say that? I'm sorry. Anyways, it's an expensive machine, and I can't afford it. And I know that, and my wife knows that, and she doesn't give me permission to buy. Wait a minute. Did I just say that too? I have controlled myself, and I haven't bought it yet. And so I've been bugging my wife, you know, like, hey, I really need to get this thing. I really need to get it. I really need to get it. And so the other day, she said, where are you going to put it? In our bedroom? No, is that going to go into our bedroom? Well, I'm going to put it in the garage. You cannot even walk in the garage. How are you going to put it there? Right? So what if you get rid of some of the stuff that you've been piling up there and you have there, and maybe if you sell some of that stuff, maybe you could bring in something like that, because you need to make space for the new things, right? So before you let go of the old things, even the old way of life, you need to make space for the new one. So Paul says, whatever were gains to me before, I now consider a loss. And if you keep reading the passage, it says, I consider them garbage. Now, this is a nice word that the Bible, the translators are using, because the actual word is manure. It's dung. It's you know what it is. So what Paul is saying in a nice way, the translator put it, and he said, look, whatever I considered before to be a good thing, now I consider it like manure. It's like that. It's not important. It's even disgusting. Because in order for you to desire this new thing, this new life, the old one needs to be pretty ordinary, pretty dull, because nobody wants to trade a good life, a successful life, a life of achievements and victories, unless you see and compare the old with the new and you realize how good the new life is, then you won't be able to put it behind you. See, the old life is built on your own efforts. It's built on your own strength. The new one is built on his achievements, on his strength. It's a new and better life. So he says, whatever I had before, I consider now a loss. But if you keep reading, you're going to find even more interesting things. For he says, in the next verse, in verse 9, he says, and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own, but the righteousness that comes through faith. Christ, the righteousness that comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness that comes from God on the basis of faith. I want to be found in him. This is important. You know why? Because people all over the world are looking for purpose, for identity. See, one of the greatest failures of today's society, with all these achievements and technology and all the cool things that we have, is that it doesn't provide people with a way to make sense of their lives. This world in which we live today doesn't let people understand why they're here for. What is the reason that they exist? Philosophy doesn't provide a way for people to understand the meaning of life. If you know anything about philosophy, you know you can go to a library and find, you know, books and more books on the subject of nothing or meaningless. Who writes a book this thick on the subject of nothing, you know? How do you write so much about nothing? I don't know. But philosophy cannot make sense, cannot help people make sense of their lives. Science cannot help people make sense of their lives. You know, one of the greatest minds of today, Stephen Hawking, brilliant scientist, says that he hopes that within the next 100 years, we will be able to find a way to live in space before we destroy each other. So the hope of the greatest scientist that there is today, and probably one of the greatest that's ever been, is that we somehow going to be able to move to Mars and live there because we're so bad here that we're going to destroy each other because we have no end purpose for life. Pleasure doesn't help you make sense of your life. Just ask anybody who made it to the top. And most of them will tell you it's not worth it. We got to the top. There's nothing at the top. But look at the next verses. Talks about being found in him, the righteousness that comes from God on the basis of faith. Now look at verse 10. I want to know him. I want to know Christ and the power of his resurrection. I want to know. I want to be found. I want to experience his power. And in these verses, these two verses, you find humanity's deepest desires and most troubling questions. Why are we here? Where do I find true peace? How do we overcome evil and suffering? Purpose, righteousness, and power. These three things are found only in the life that the Son of God can offer you. For this new life has a new way, and it's sort of like a new beginning to us. Let's move on to the next verses in 12. Paul says, not that I have already obtained all this or have already arrived at my goal, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me. Brothers and sisters, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it, but one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining toward what is ahead, I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me in Christ Jesus. So you probably know Bill Falcons, because he worked here for a lot of years. He still works here, I guess, right? And it was on my second year that I was here at Creekside when he came, and immediately you can tell that he's a very sharp, intelligent man, but you can also notice that he's not very concerned about the things of the church, the spiritual life of the church. At that moment, he didn't seem to be. He seemed to be a good Christian, but he wasn't like very in tune with the things of the church. But as he spent more time with you guys and more time with the elders, especially the elders, because they're so good. That was a joke. And as he spent more time with the pastors around you, he began to change. He began to experience more and more this new thing, this new life. And one day, I remember we were at one of our staff meetings, which I missed so much. You know, those Wednesday mornings, like I really missed being a staff meeting. Best nap of my life. No, just kidding. So one morning he says, he came, he looked kind of excited, and he said, hey guys, I want to share something with you. And he said, look, I read in Ecclesiastes that it says that there's nothing new under the sun. And I'm like, yeah, that's true. That's what the Bible says. And then he says, but this is the interesting thing he says. I read in Isaiah that God says, behold, I am doing a new thing. And I was like, oh, that's interesting. And so I kind of remember him saying something like, so I just realized that there's really nothing new except if God makes something new. Then there is something new under the sun. That sounds really interesting to me. And I was remembering that when I read this passage, because here Paul recognizes that he's not there yet. He still hasn't grasped all of the new things, but he's moving towards it. And I know you understand this. Because if there is anything, well, there are many things I appreciate about the American culture, but if there is something that is really good about the American culture is that you guys know how to persevere. You have a lot of determination. There is something, you know, like the American power, like you guys like to and want to push and never quit and continue going, and that's a good thing. And now and then you have to stop pushing and consider, is it worth it? Is it worth what I'm doing, what I'm getting? Is it a good thing? And Paul says here, I press on. I keep on going. I am assuming he knows the thing ahead is a good thing. Look at the next verse. In verse 12, I read it before, but this is very important. It says, not that I have already obtained all this, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me. Now, what does that mean? He says, I press on, I have determination, I keep going to take hold of that which Christ Jesus took hold of me. It's a little complicated, right? But I think what he's saying is, and this is important, if you want to write it down, it's okay. If not, it's going to be in the screen. That the reason why he took hold of me, the reason why he took hold of you, was so he could take you to the new life that is waiting for you. This new thing, this new life, is so important. It's so valuable. It's so incredibly good that the Son of God took hold of you so he could take you to it. My friend Mike Orbital, who's preaching at our church today, he's one of our elders. Took his son David, at the time he was 15, he took him to Norway. That's where his family is from. I'm from Germany, he's from Norway. And he took his son there to, you know, to show him where, you know, his family came from, and also because his son David wants to be a missionary and a photographer. And he wants to use his photography to support his work as a missionary. He's one of the kids from our church. And so Mike, his dad, decided that he's going to take him there, and then he's going to take him on a very long and hard hike to get to a place where he knows David is going to be able to take some amazing pictures. And he told me that they walked and walked and walked and walked. And at some moments, you know, he encouraged his son, and then sometimes he pushed him, he carried him, he carried the gear, he endured, and they walked for hours until they got to the other side. And when they got there, and his son took the pictures, and they showed me the pictures. They were so amazing. Like, I couldn't believe that there are places like that on earth. Like, so beautiful. And I was thinking, that is a beautiful picture of the way in which Christ Jesus takes hold of you and encourages you and carries you and gives you the strength so one day you'll be able to see how good and how pleasant and how beautiful the life that he gives you is. Because this new life with this new way, like a new beginning, is much more fulfilling and beautiful than you could ever imagine. It is worth it to take hold of it. See, after meeting in this church for about 8 years, we decided that it was time to move on. You know, despite the many obstacles that we had in front of us and the many things that we had to do, we knew that if we wanted to be the church that God wanted us to be, we needed to move out of here. But believe me, we had a good life here. We were very happy in this church. We had everything provided. People were loving, and things were good for us. We never had to worry about anything. We were growing. Things were good. Life was good when we were at First Baptist. And then God moved us to a different location. And I want to say this, but I understand what I'm saying. I'm not saying that this was bad. I'm saying that God had a dream for us. And despite our difficulties and our challenges, the life of the church that it is today in South Sacramento is better than the life that the church could have had here. Why? Because God had a different desire for us. See, even with what happened last week somebody broke into our building and stole our three new 65-inch TV. And this is not the first time that something like this happens. But despite even those things, we know that it is worth it to be there because we're fulfilling God's purposes for His church. And so, what about you? I know you have a good life. But the new life of Christ, the one that He offers you, is a lot better than the one that you have today. Imagine if you started this year taking hold of this new life. Imagine how that would change your life and the life of the people around you. Imagine how this is going to affect your community and even Creekside. Imagine what could happen if we collectively took hold of the life of Christ, the new thing that God is doing, and we move on with Him. I just want to suggest one thing as one little step for you to embark yourself in this movement of God. Next week, you've heard before, there is sign-ups for the life groups. And you might not think that that's a big deal, but it is. There's community and growth, and there is outreach, and a lot of things that happen in those places. This is a very small step. If you haven't signed up, if you are not, you know, thinking about being part of a fellowship, do it, because that will put you in a path for this new life to flourish in you. And I pray and I continue to pray that you will take hold of the life of Christ, this new thing, this beautiful thing that God has called us to live with Him. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for this morning. We thank you for the life that you give us in Christ. We thank you that we are able to see what we have today and even put it behind us and move towards the goal. Father, give us the grace, give us the confidence. Help us see that it is worth it, that the life that you have for us is so much better than the one we are experiencing today. We thank you for your Holy Spirit, and we thank you for speaking to us through your word, and we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Tony. At this time, we're going to call upon our ushers to